Ionic equations. Typically, equations are written in molecular form. Here, for example, hydrogen chloride plus sodium hydroxide gives sodium chloride plus water. And we've made a few notations. In parentheses is the word aqueous. That means that this particular material dissolves. Sodium hydroxide dissolves as well. Sodium hydroxide is an ionic compound, and you'd expect it to dissolve in water. HCl is a covalent molecule, but it's polar covalent. And oftentimes, polar covalent molecules dissolve in water. We've made the notation that sodium chloride, of course, dissolves in water. And if we have a solid, liquid, or gas, we use the, in parentheses, an L for liquid, or an S for a solid, or a G for gas. And this is called the molecular equation. Because this reaction takes place in water, and because these materials can dissociate or ionize, it's appropriate to indicate the ions that actually form in water. So as HCl breaks apart to form H plus and Cl minus, we'd predict this because chlorine is in group 7a, has seven valence electrons, it needs one more, so it tends to take on a minus charge. That means the hydrogen has a positive charge. With sodium hydroxide, sodium's in group 1a, so it forms a plus 1 ion. OH is a polyatomic ion, and you could look up in the table within the text to see that the charge is a minus 1. Or if you forget, well, you know that it's got to balance the sodium plus 1, so the charge on OH must be a minus 1. Over here, sodium again, group 1a, form a plus 1, chlorine a minus 1, and we'd rewrite water the way it is in an unionized form. Water can form ions, but it's a lot more accurate to write it as H2O. This is called the total ionic equation. We've indicated everything in ions where they break apart and dissociate. And you'll notice something interesting about this equation. On the left-hand side, we have Cl minus, and again, it's repeated over here on the right-hand side. The same is true of sodium ion. Well, these are called spectator ions. They're written in exactly the same form on the left and on the right. They're really just sort of watching the reaction take place. When we subtract out the spectator ions from the total ionic equation, we're left with the net ionic equation. In this case, H plus plus OH minus to give H2O. And notice that the charges balance. Over here it's neutral. On that side it's neutral as well. There are really three skills here. Once you have a molecular equation, one of the skills would be to write the total ionic equation, to identify the spectator ions, and then to write the net ionic equation. In this equation, we have calcium chloride plus sodium carbonate to produce NaCl plus CaCO3. And three of these materials are aqueous, meaning that they dissolve in water. The calcium carbonate, clear on the right-hand side, is a solid. That means that it'll sit there on the bottom of the flask or float on top. It'll appear as a precipitate. It won't dissolve in the water. This would be the molecular equation. Let's write it in total ionic form now. Calcium's in group 2a. That means that it likes to form a 2 plus ion. Chlorine, group 7a, likes to form a minus 1. So we'll write the minus 1. The subscript tells us that there are two chlorines, so we've got to put the 2 Cl minus. Same way with sodium. The subscript indicates that there are two sodiums, so we'll put that subscript now as a coefficient. Sodium's in group 1a, likes to form a plus 1. And, well, perhaps carbonate you could look it up in the table in the text and see that it likes to form a 2 minus, or if you'd like to work it out, you know it's the charge has got to balance these two positive sodiums, so the charge must be 2 minus on the carbonate. Over on the right-hand side, we get two molecules of sodium chloride, so we have two sodium ions, two chloride ions, and because the calcium carbonate is written as a solid, does not dissolve, we won't break it apart into ions, we'll just repeat its formula. This would be the total ionic equation. Notice the spectator ions now. Here's chlorine, handsome sodium, on the left and on the right in exactly the same form. Those are the spectator ions. So let's subtract them out. We have calcium plus carbonate to give calcium carbonate as our net ionic equation. Net ionic equations are pretty useful. They're sort of like a generic reaction. What this really says that any source of calcium plus any source of carbonate is going to form calcium carbonate. And so we, knowing a net ionic equation, we can predict lots and lots of reactions. For example, we used sodium carbonate as the source of carbonate, but we could have used potassium or lithium or ammonium, various carbonates, and produce the same reaction. Of these three skills, you'll always be given the molecular equation, and once you've got the total ionic, I think it's pretty easy to identify the spectator ions, and then to subtract the spectator ions to get the net ionic equation. Maybe the toughest skill is breaking things apart into ions. Let's practice that just a little bit. Lithium nitrate is an ionic compound. We'd expect it to dissolve in water and to ionize, to break apart into ions. Lithium is in group 1A. It likes to form a plus 1. Then we see two more elements, nitrogen and oxygen. And any time we have two or more elements over here, it's a good bet that it's probably a polyatomic ion. In this case, the polyatomic ion nitrate. And again, you could memorize or look up in the text, the charge that goes with nitrate, or it's really quite easy just to work backwards. Lithium is a plus 1, means nitrate has to be a minus 1. Magnesium bromide would be an ionic compound. We see a metal in combination with a nonmetal. Magnesium's in group 2A. It likes to form a 2 plus. Bromine is in 7A, likes to form a minus 1. Subscript tells us that there are two of those, so the subscript becomes a coefficient now. There might be a temptation to balance this magnesium 2 plus with Br2 2 minus. Well, the charges would balance, but this really doesn't work down here because of the octet rule. Bromine likes to be by itself and have a negative 1 charge. If bromine does come together with another bromine to form Br2, which obeys the octet rule, then it has no charge. So Br2, 2 minus, would be an easy error to make. With sodium phosphate, we have a metal in combination with a polyatomic ion. Sodium's in group 1A, likes to form a plus 1. The subscript now becomes the coefficient. We'd have 3 sodium ions, and balancing that 3 plus would be a 3 minus on the phosphate. Just as we've worked backwards to get the charge on the phosphate, we can work backwards to get the charge on the iron in this case. Iron is a transition element. It's a metal, likes to give up electrons, likes to be positive, but because it's in that center section of the periodic table, we really can't predict what charge is going to be on the iron, whether it'll be a plus 2 or a plus 3, and that's true of the other transition metals as well. But we can always work backwards, so let's do it in this case. We do know something about chlorine. Group 7A likes to form a minus 1 ion. The subscript becomes a coefficient. We've got three negative charges. That means that the iron must be a 3+.